Thanks, Shamus, for agreeing to talk to me about your book. I've got a few questions for you. And the first one I wanted to ask you, really, to get the discussion going, was why focus on posh kids?
Part of the reason I'm interested in focusing on posh kids, the wealthy, is because when we look at patterns of inequality over the last 40 years, it's really been the increase in the wealth of the rich that's driven inequality. So a kind of methodological point here is that if you have something that's changed, you can't explain that change by a constant. You have to explain it by something else that's also changed. And if we look at the position of the middle classes or even the poor in the United States over the last 40 years, we see they've pretty much been locked in place. But we also know that inequality has increased considerably. So we know it's not really the middle class and poor that are explaining the rise in inequality. It has to be something else. And that something else is the rich getting a lot richer. And so for me, the reason I focus on the rich or the posh is because they're where a lot of the action is. And typically when we do studies of inequality, we don't always think about the rich. We usually think about the poor.
In the book, you include lots of examples of the importance of symbolism and metaphor mm-hmm. in the life of the school. Can you tell us a little bit about the senior couch and the school crest?
Sure. I think that the use of symbolism here is a kind of classic technique in cultural sociology. And it's something that cultural sociologists really like to do to give a sense of sort of the community beyond. And I wanted to give the experience of hierarchy a kind of material presence, a sense of how it was really lived and experienced by the students. And the senior couch is a really good example of this, because it's a place on campus that only seniors can sit. And one of the nice things about the senior couch also, I think, is that it shows some of the ordinariness of the school. So I would say that a lot of high schools, whether very posh or not, had something like the senior couch. And sometimes when we look at the elite, we tend to fetishize everything that they do as being about elites. And so for me, the symbol of the senior couch does sort of work on two levels. It one shows the real importance of hierarchy to the institution, but then it also helps show the ways in which the institution is kind of like a lot of other institutions. And so walking that balance is important to the book.
I wanted to ask you about the distinction you draw between the arrogance of entitlement and the ease of privilege, and your suggestion that perhaps this says something about the difference between elite schools in the US and elite schools in Europe.
The idea of the arrogance of entitlement versus the ease of privilege does a few things in the book. The first is to kind of suggest a change in the character of the American elite. So I kind of tell this, you know, sort of light historical story about a move from the elite as thinking of themselves as a class to the elite as thinking of themselves as very talented individuals. And in that way, the kind of arrogance of entitlement is tied to a sort of class dynamics, an idea that the position really matters and that certain people are kind of entitled to hold the position. And that is associated with extreme arrogance. Now, I think this could be challenged a little bit because I attempt to contrast that with the idea that class doesn't matter that much among the modern day elite, which is not to say that class doesn't matter, it's that it doesn't matter for how they think about themselves. And they often, in their rhetoric, aggressively challenge the idea of entitlement or that they've inherited anything. And by class here, just quickly, what I mean is that they share a kind of culture, they share a set of social ties, and they share a kind of association with institutions, like St. Paul's, like Harvard, and even the institution could be their family. And so part of the move to the ease of privilege is the individualization of this, how it's individual level talents. I think that part of the historical story could also map onto a distinction between the Europe and the US, in large part because in the United States, Americans are highly attuned to racial politics. I think in a way that Europeans aren't, to be quite blunt about it. I mean, I think I've just come back from France, and never in my life have I been asked with more consistency where I'm from. And they don't mean, are you from New York? They actually want they want a narrative of my lineage. But in here in Britain, as an example, I think that there's a people are quite attuned to class politics, not as attuned to racial politics. And in the U.S., it's sort of the reverse. We're very attuned to racial politics because of the Civil War and because of the civil rights movements, and not so attuned to class politics. And this creates a kind of tension around the idea of class politics. But I think that if I were to challenge this idea a little bit, I think that people who think of themselves as individuals have a certain arrogance to them. And the arrogance that they have is the belief that they are really talented, that what explains their position is the fact that they're hardworking, smart, and have a set of skills that other people don't have. And class position may have an arrogance of its position, but it doesn't necessarily have that kind of arrogance of just how the quality of the kind of individual you are as your sort of core. But for me, the reason I make this argument, even given that sort of slight problem, is that I think that it's important to recognize the ways in which ease across a host of situations is really important, particularly for the American context. So the argument of ease is that rather than position yourself within a class, within a group of people, you position yourself as a kind of person who can move very freely across situations or contexts. And the argument that I make about cultural omnivores is really the best example about this. So to think about the ranges of music that people listen to, the kinds of meals that they eat, they represent an omnivorousness, a vision of a kind of flat world that you're at ease at, rather than a hierarchical world of class divisions where you belong somewhere because of some inheritance or association.
And one of the things you argue in the book as well is that there's an embodiment to that ease. Can you say a little bit about that?
Sure. I mean, the idea behind the embodiment of that ease is really taken from the work of Pierre Bourdieu. And the idea is that the ease naturalizes socially produced distinctions. So there's something rather unnatural about class, by which I mean that if you think that you're part of an association because you have these cultural tastes, social ties, and associations with institutions, the implication is, when I say unnatural, that it's a socially produced distinction. It's a distinction that emerges because of the kind of society that you live in. And by a naturally produced distinction, what I mean is that it's something about the core of who you are as a human being. And what embodiment does for me in this argument is, and what the argument of ease does, is suggest that the naturalness or the ease with which people move throughout a situation, it helps explain why they're so successful. So that instead of the distinction being produced because of the class position that somebody inherits, it's produced because of almost the genetic composition of the person, the ways in which they embody their everyday life. There's nothing more natural, it seems, than our body. And so since it's such a natural thing, it becomes actually much more difficult to question than a kind of class politics. And what I hope to show in the book is just how difficult that embodiment is to produce. So how it's a deeply part of a social process. One of my favorite examples of this, you know, it comes from Foucault, and the idea there is that bodies are heavily disciplined. So for the students, it took a long time for the students in the classroom to be trained to sit in a chair for hours on end. And that's a kind of corporeal discipline. It's a bodily disciplining that has a huge effect on the ways in which you carry yourself. If by contrast you had to squat all the time, you'd have a different corporeal carriage. And that's an idea, like a kind of coarse idea, of the ways in which your physical experiences in the social world have an impact on your sort of natural body. And I put natural in quotes there for a reason. But that the body itself makes it seem as if there's no social impact. It's instead a kind of naturalized process.
So can you say what light you think your study sheds on Bourdieu's claim that schools treat social gifts as natural gifts?
So I think that I'm really, part of what I do is really an application of Bourdieu. And so there's a lot of discussion of Bourdieu, particularly in the American context, of whether or not he's just too French. And as the arguments that he makes are very specific to the French context, but if you, they don't travel very well. And I think that a lot of what I do is a way to show that the ideas do travel really well. But at the same time, I try to show that some of the ideas need to be amended in different contexts. So it's not a pure application of this idea of Bourdieu. And the way in which I do that is really in the first chapter. The Chase Abbott, who begins the book, is, and Evan Williams, who's later on in the book, is, for me, the reason I begin the book with him, the classic Bourdieuian character. He is the person in the book who should be the most successful if Bourdieu is right. That is, he's the person who spent the most amount of time in these institutions, who has family associated with these institutions, who, you know, kind of purely embodies the institutional logic. And yet, the first thing we learn is that Chase Abbott kind of fails. And that's done quite intentionally. So the setup is sort of to begin you with this guy who should be really successful if we were to listen to Bourdieu and isn't quite successful. And then to use Bourdieu to sort of explain why the classic Bourdieuian case doesn't really apply in the American context and to think of it in a sort of different way. And so to use Bourdieu to think about the juxtaposition between the language of meritocracy, the rhetoric that's deployed of meritocracy among the students, and the ease of privilege, so the embodied disposition of privilege. And here the juxtaposition between the rhetoric and the embodied is really important for me. And I think that's something that I add a little bit beyond the Bourdieu, because, I mean, one other challenge I would put to Bourdieu is that a lot of his research is based upon surveys, not a lot of direct observation, particularly of these kinds of dynamics. And so for me, it's a drive to think about, if we do direct observations of these institutions, what do we see?
Can you tell me what it was like to do research in your own school?
It was a little strange to do research in my own school. I mean, I hadn't been away that long. It had been, 7 or 8 years since I'd been there, maybe 7 years. And so many of the teachers who were now my colleagues had been my teachers before. I mean, I still remember going to my first cocktail party with the other faculty and finding it terribly strange. It also posed a set of methodological challenges. So things that other people would have found strange could be taken for granted for me. And so this meant having to be a little diligent in the ways in which I made observations to try and sort of at least see the school not as a total insider. But it also gave me huge advantages, which was that the students were often very interested in the history of the school, the legacy of the institution. And as someone who was from that institution, I was seen as having a kind of authenticity. Also, it may seem not like a very short period of time, a year to do research, but it's a relatively short period of time to try and master the social life of an institution. And to be blunt, it gave me a kind of leg up, a capacity to do a very concentrated research project and not have to sort of learn from the very, very, from the ground up. Finally, I'll say that there's an enormous number of teachers at the school who are products of boarding school. And part of the reason for this is that the corporeal demands of being at boarding school are considerable, or the everyday life demands. So going to school 6 days a week, getting up at 8 and being done with your day by 11 p.m., everybody does that, but they don't always do that in a fishbowl. That is, in a context where there's 600 other people who are doing it, and everything you do is sort of observable. And this, to someone who hasn't experienced it before, can be kind of crushing really, really psychologically difficult. But for me, it was actually kind of simple. And I think that enabled me to do the research in a way that I wouldn't have been able to do if I was sort of coming to the place completely anew. But I think it's important for the reader to recognize that someone else who might have done the same ethnography at the same time perhaps would have come up with very different observations because they would have seen as novel what I took for granted.
What was the response of the school to your book?
The response of the school to my book was varied. So the head of the school at the time sent me an email telling me he was no longer talking to me, which was sort of a strange email to receive from a 70-year-old man. In general, the school, I think, you have to keep in mind, is a very powerful institution. And so one little book by one little academic isn't really going to do much to damage the reputation of a you know, century and a half old institution. And on, you know, the other, I think that the school took the book as a little bit of a sort of learning experience. So the new head of the school, you know, gives the book out. He thinks of it as a kind of reflection. But another, I think, advantage for the school is that academic projects take a while. So they, you know, when I was done with the project, it's not as if the book came out. It took another 5 years for me to get the book, you know, written and then published. And no one who was at the school as a student was still at the school by the time the book was published. And that kind of turnaround allowed the school to sort of say, there's some truth to this book. There's some things that we disagree with. But, you know, we've moved forward as an institution. We fixed a lot of these problems. And I think that sort of allowed them to have a kind of a distance, a comfortable distance from the argument. I also think that the book is somewhat challenging to the school. It is not, it's not too salacious or critical. And in many ways, the people who liked the book the most from the school saw it in the way that I was trying to write it, which is that it's not a book about St. Paul's School. It's a book about the changing dynamic of elites, class, and race in American life, and it uses the school to make the argument. And so if the argument has legs, if it's a strong argument, it doesn't require St. Paul's to make the argument. I could have and should have been able to do it in other kinds of places. And so I think, you know, trying to write the book in that way, to both give an accurate ethnographic portrait of this place without making it so much about the place that it couldn't be generalizable beyond it, helped people at the school see that what I was talking about was changing American dynamics of the elite rather than St. Paul's School in 2005.
You write in your book that you're not sentimental about your own time at school. Could you explain that comment?
I wasn't sentimental about my own time at school, in large part because it awoke in me a sense of inequality that I hadn't really been aware of before that period in time. And, you know, this could be that I was either very naive or my family was not very political. While I was at the school, I was actually quite happy and pretty successful as a student, both academically and socially. So I was, you know, elected by my peers to represent my class on the governing body of the institution upon graduation. And I won the award of the student that best represents the school. So this was, you know, I was certainly not a kind of depressive or isolated student. But the more time I spent away from the institution, the more strange it sort of appeared to me. And the more I began to learn about patterns of inequality, the more I began to think quite critically about institutions like St. Paul's. And so I think part of it was that my politics shifted and I began to reflect back on this experience with a kind of critical eye. And also what I knew about the world changed. I sort of had a broader perspective about the economic and social relations of American society. For students in this class, I think they should keep in mind just how segregated American neighborhoods are. And it's hard to convey the degree of residential segregation to people who aren't from the United States. But the basic idea is that if you're from a wealthy background, you don't see many poor people ever, except maybe, you know, if you go out for a walk into a different neighborhood. But even that doesn't happen that much. When you even go into the city, when you go into New York, you tend to stay in wealthier neighborhoods. And also that it's not just that wealthy people live together, white people live together. And so there's an enormous racial component to this as well. And so, you know, my time at St. Paul's put this into relief for me, and my time away led to me really actually beginning to study this. And that sort of took away a lot of the sheen of my education. It made me a lot less sentimental about this experience that had been very important to me and actually that I was, you know, not terribly unhappy with at the time.
I note that your book has been translated into Chinese.
Oh, yes.
How did that come about, and how did you feel about
that? Yeah, so the book's been translated into Chinese, and I just signed the French translation rights, which will be interesting. I think the Chinese one is much more interesting. It came about because I had a group of Chinese students studying with me at Columbia who read the book and found it absolutely fascinating. And for two reasons. One, they sort of didn't know that institutions like that existed in the United States. So there's a sense of American exceptionalism, how America is very different from Europe. And part of that difference is that it doesn't have these kinds of institutions of almost wealth building or exclusivity. Instead, it's more flat and open. So to see the ways in which the U.S. isn't that exceptional, there's a kind of American Eden, was surprising to them. It's also actually surprising to some Americans when they read it. They don't even know that some of these institutions exist. The second is that the Chinese educational system is transforming right now. It's under major restructuring, and there's proposals to construct boarding schools there and these kind of elite schools, and they exist in some of the major urban centers. And so as a kind of portrayal of what these institutions are like in the U.S., they thought it would be useful to bring it back to China. I've yet to receive the book in China. I was told that, I mean, this is kind of a funny aside, that as soon as the book is published, it will be photocopied and sold by other people at all kinds of college campuses, things like that. But I'm still very excited to sort of, to see the Chinese version. They sent me the page proofs, which is the proofs of the pages before it's published so that you can check for errors. But there was, I mean, there's no way I can check for errors in Chinese. So we'll see what it looks like. But it was primarily because I had students who were from China who found it interesting and wanted to bring the book back to China when they returned.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thanks for having me. Thanks for reading the book.